critical thinking, logic, and a whole raft of other things as well, in order they get the broadest possible type of education. And I'm pleased to say that we've got two students from NCH, third year, sitting in the back row, and also the head of our politics department sitting in the penultimate row. But it gives me great pleasure to welcome the chair of this session, the afternoon session, Professor Eugene Rogan, who is the head of the Middle East, Middle East Centre at St. Anthony's, Oxford. And a brand new centre too, a brand new building, fantastic building.
Lovely, thank you so much. And may I say how pleased I am to make my first visit to the new College for the Humanities. And with all of the controversy that the creation of this institution has generated, I'd like to put myself squarely in the camp of those pro this institution. I salute any initiative that tries to put the humanities squarely at the center of the educational enterprise. I think with all of our effort to try and foster leadership forums and management styles and God knows what, we forget that the greatest leaders the world has ever known all took their education in the humanities. And I think so long as there are institutions such as this one, we can hope to continue to turn out people for whom enlightened discourse will lead to better policies. So, from strength to strength. My name is Eugene Rogan, and as a historian of the modern Middle East, it's a particular pleasure to be chairing today's session, bringing together research from three scholars who are presenting what is really cutting-edge new research on the Great War, and even more, on its aftermath, on the kind of enduring influences the region had. And I think in the spread of subjects covered by these three papers, we're reminded of just how extensively influenced the Great War on the Middle East was. So we will have three speakers. Harrison Guthorn from the University of Maryland will be speaking on Transjordan. Point of order, a battle for autonomy in the first legislative council of Transjordan. And I, more than anyone else in this room, can appreciate just what he's about to tell us. Our second speaker will be Dónal Hassett from the European University in Florence, though he is a native of course, Dublin, and not someone, as his biography might lead you to believe, who spends his life shuttling between London and Saudi Arabia. I've just been assured that he has not been to the latter country. I refer you otherwise to the biographies of the participants. Dónal will be speaking on citizen soldiers or subject soldiers, the Indigenous Veterans Movement, and the quest for citizenship in Interwar, Algeria. Our third speaker from Alexandria is Amany Soliman. Amany will be speaking on the rise of Egyptian nationalism and the perception of foreigners in Egypt between 1914 and 1923. We are in for an intellectual feast. Each speaker has been given 25 minutes. I'll make a couple of comments at the end of their presentations and then open the proceedings to you for your questions. Could I ask our first speaker, Harrison, to come to the podium? Thank you.
First, I'd like to thank the Gingko Library for inviting me, and in particular, it's a pleasure to give my paper with Eugene Rogan as the chair. For those of you who don't know, Dr. Rogan's first work was on the history of Transjordan during the Ottoman period, and he's the only person who's published an article on Mandate Era Imam. So if I screw up, he will be literally one of the three people in the earth who can tell me I have, which is just fantastic. So this is just an image of Amman during the 40s, just to start us off. Okay. So how am I getting us to the Legislative Council? How am I getting us to a battle of autonomy from World War I? Well, we first have to consider are the British mandate and the mandate system in general. How is this different from the colonial system? What's the purpose? And how did they function? And a lot of that has to do with what British goals were in the region. So we need to remember that the British goals during World War I is to occupy territory largely so that someone else doesn't have it. So that the French don't have it, the Germans don't have it, eventually so the Ottomans don't have it. But more than that, there's a lack of a firm British policy. They're interested in protecting and maintaining the status quo, whether that is oil coming out of Iraq, from Kirkuk in particular, or shipping out of Haifa, or the ever-important Suez, or the path to India. And we don't get until 1924 when we actually have any type of imperial policy where Lord L.S. Amery, the Secretary of the State of the Colonies, makes a comment that they need to protect the southern flank of the empire and he acknowledges that Palestine is the keystone of that empire. So with that in mind, it still begs the question, why Transjordan? Why do they care? A lot of that has to do with the fact that it's between Iraq and it's between Palestine. So a lot of what is done in Transjordan is to maintain security. It's to maintain and make sure that Transjordan isn't going to be problematic in between these arguably more important holdings for the British Empire. But then why enter into an agreement? Why enter into a treaty? They had everything they needed technically from the League of Nations mandate. That's where things are a bit different than earlier imperial holdings. I would argue that within the mandate system, with in particular in Iraq and then later in Transjordan, the British felt a need to have a degree of local buy-in. They needed so that they could point in some way and say they are fulfilling the League of Mandates charter to have some degree of acceptance, some degree of understanding as to why the mandate is there. So this happens first in Iraq in 1922. An agreement is created by the British government, and unlike his brother, Amir Faisal initially is strongly in opposition to the agreement in Iraq. And if it perhaps was not for a rather fortuitous bout of appendicitis, he might not have remained the Emir of Iraq. He had opposed it so strongly. But shortly thereafter, he comes to understand that he has to vouch for this agreement, because it's the only way he is going to maintain his authority within Iraq at that point. So after his bout of appendicitis and after Iraq accepts the agreement in 1923, we come to Abdullah and we come to Transjordan. So the role of the agreement in Transjordan is much the same. It's the degree of local buy-in and the idea that they don't think there will be that much opposition. But this is where things come apart, where things actually develop in a rather different way in Transjordan. The opposition that is concentrated within Transjordan is concentrated within the First Legislative Council of Transjordan. Throughout its first session, its members jockeyed for control over language, authority, prominence, and prestige and status. Simply put, they fought over what it would mean to be a member of the elite of Transjordan. Most of all, council proceedings demonstrated the earliest attempts by the representatives to combat the growing gravitational pull of the new capital of Amman. Although they were eventually defeated, this lost to the will of the government, and Abdullah was far from preordained. The council proceedings at their heart are a battle over who would control the future of the emirate. The government over time learned to use the Legislative Council chamber and its representatives as a means of incorporating formerly autonomous elites into the machinery of the state. What once were independent, autonomous, and self-directed regional notables of Ajloun, Karak, Man, and Salt became Transjordanian elites. I'm going to explain this argument by breaking down the actual proceedings of the 1928 Anglo-Transjordanian Agreement into four parts. First, how the mandatory agreement was understood by Abdullah, the elections and the earliest forms of protest, the creation of the internal regulations of the Legislative Council, which were essentially the parliamentary rules that they would operate under, and finally, the actual ratification debate within the Legislative Council itself. So unlike his brother Faisal, Abdullah was prepared, in the words of High Commissioner Herbert Plumer, prepared to accept the treaty and indeed anxious to bring it into force. So the understanding immediately that Abdullah is very much in favor of this agreement, that he doesn't have reason to oppose it. And the reason he doesn't have any strong opposition to it is the terms of the agreement as it's presented to Abdullah first in 1925 are inherently advantageous for the emir. Most of the power is rested with the executive. He has powers of override with it's the executive irade to override legislative authority, override other types of influence. But that's not to say that there wasn't opposition within Abdullah's own camp. The executive council, which at various times is called the council of ministers, or essentially is his cabinet, has a couple of dissident voices, the most notable of which is his chief secretary, Arif al-Arif. Arif al-Arif is an Arab nationalist from Jerusalem, and he remains a prominent public figure throughout his life. He eventually will become the mayor of Amman in the 1950s. And Arif al-Arif refers to the agreement as a farce. He refers to it the chains and shackles of the nation. And he believes that by buying into this agreement, Transjordan is dooming themselves, that they have no hope for development, that they are letting the aftermath of World War I determine what their fate will be and doom them before they've begun. And within his memoirs, which are at St. Anthony's in Oxford, he mentions that when the agreement is finally actually agreed to, Abdullah pushes the agreement through, dismisses their reservations by saying that there's always room for amendment later on. We need to accept the agreement and we can always amend it after the fact. So he pushes through that, and the thing that's most telling is the chief minister of the time, Hassan Khalid Abdul Huda, is sent to Jerusalem, in theory, to finish the negotiations for the 1928 agreement. And he confides to Arif Arif that he was not sent to negotiate, he was sent to sign. That he had no power to actually amend the agreement. That he was sent there as Abdullah's rubber stamp and nothing more. So by 1928, the actual 1928 agreement has been signed in Jerusalem on February 20th, 1928. And once it's published, once the actual agreement is signed, the British are convinced this is going to be a simple process. The agreement is signed, the next step was the formation of a legislative council, which then had to ratify the agreement, and then they would move forward. But, and that does not take place. Instead, this almost immediate upswell of opposition to the agreement takes place. And people are upset of having to deal with a centralized authority in Amman. They're upset with the idea of being under British control. And a telling quote from a group of northern tribal elders, I apologize, it's not more specific than that. They don't identify themselves any more specifically than that. We strongly protest against the treatment and inform you that the nation does not accept absolute treaties that are used as instruments of slavery. The British reject this fear, and they say, oh, this is all just fear about conscription. This is the memory of Ottoman conscription from World War I. That's all the natives are really afraid of. And Abdullah does, in fact, he's able to bring some of these tribal elites from the Bani Sakhr tribe and the Adwan tribe to Amman and convince them, oh, Article 10 of the agreement doesn't mean conscription. It just means you have to register to be able to vote. It's nothing more. But they don't really believe him. What remains critical, though, when we look at how the opposition is created and where the opposition is coming from, is that Ottoman precedent. The Ottoman precedent, so the Ottoman Empire reinforces their authority over what will become Transjordan in the latter half of the 19th century. And where they reinforce their authority in particular is in the largely settled province of Ajlun, and then to a lesser degree, the Balka. So Amman today is in what would be called the Balka. And they have their Ottoman provincial capital in Salt. When we go forward and we see where the opposition is coming from, not surprisingly, the stronger opposition comes from territory that's never directly under Ottoman control or had fought Ottoman control beforehand. So in particular, Karak and to the south, Ma'an are the strongest opponents of the agreement. They don't see the need for a centralized government. They are organized loosely along tribal confederations with elites being attached to a certain tribe or a certain city, and they don't understand why they should do so. The 1928 electoral law is passed, and it's determined there will be 14 seats that are elected on the Legislative Council, but again, it's not a direct election, it's an indirect election. So the registration that I mentioned was for the first wave of popular voting that all men could vote for, and then there would be the secondary election who would actually decide who were the members of the council. And in addition to being determined by district, where there were 5 seats for the Ajlun, 5 for the Balka, and 4 for Karak, as they're already rigging it so that the people who are less happy with them are less likely to be part of the council. And also, if you notice, Ma'an isn't listed at all, because the opposition in Ma'an is so strong, they just don't include them in the election. And then in addition to that, they also do divisions along sectarian lines. where there will be 9 Muslim Arabs, 3 Arab Christians, and 2 Circassians. The reason that's important is the demographics at this point are overwhelmingly within Transjordan Muslim Arabs. The reason there are so many Arab Christian Circassian members is that because they were groups that had invested interest in the security of this new British state. The Circassians had been favorable to the Ottomans beforehand, they understood the role of the centralized government, and they continue that same general perspective moving forward in the mandate period. As well, we also have 2 Bedouin members. The 2 Bedouin members are also curious because Transjordan is very artificially divided into northern tribes and southern tribes. Abdullah then appoints 10 members to a council who will then pick 1 tribal sheikh to be on the council. The problem with this is that the Bedouin view this as essentially the election of the premier sheikh of the north and the premier sheikh of the south. They don't view this as being a member of a legislative or representational body. So with all of that being said, the elections do take place, but before the elections themselves, we have a formal creation of the opposition and what becomes known as the National Congress. The National Congress first meets on July 25th, 1928, and it referred to as a coalition of 150 notable sheikhs and intellectuals in Hamdan Coffee House in central Amman. What is important about Hamdan Coffee House is when I say it's in the center of Amman, I mean it's the dead center of Amman. Hamdan Coffee House, which you can see, this is from inside, this is an image during a military parade of the central square of Amman, Faisal Square, is right there. These are not meetings of opposition held in secret. You could not pick a more public place, probably in all of Transjordan. And that tells you something about the degree of intellectual freedom or political freedom that they have at this point in 1928 and 1929. This is not a scared opposition. This is a very vocal and forceful opposition that is sending petitions to the League of Nations, sending petitions directly to British officials, sending petitions outside the League of Nations. They send a petition to President Wilson, President after Wilson, whose name escapes me. But the centrality of Amman is ironic and paradoxical because they are strongly protesting the centralized state in Amman, but they're doing it in Amman. By the time we hit 1929, it is exceptionally clear that Amman is the center of political intrigue and political life in Transjordan. There are no other options. So initially, the Legislative Council, initially the opposition sends a letter to British resident Henry Cox saying, basically, we protest the terms of the agreement and request their amendment. British resident Cox dismisses this out of hand, saying, this agreement is important, and you need it to help further separate Transjordan from Palestine. And this is a purposeful fallacy. Transjordan has been separated from Palestine since 1923. That is not the role of the 1928 agreement. They then send a petition called the National Pact, which is members formally sign on to as being deemed as part of the formal opposition, which is a term that's thrown around about this period. And that's sent to the League of Nations. The British refute this by saying, oh, it was only signed by 5 men of standing, and that the boycott itself really wasn't that important. Despite the fact that there is opposition, the elections themselves are still entirely valid. So the commission said, the commission was of the opinion that the complaints submitted by the petitioners were not of such a nature to call for any action. So with that in mind, the elections did go forward, and 5 members of the official opposition, as I referred to, the signers of the National Pact are elected. Atala al-Sukhaymat of Karak, Syed al-Mufti, who's a Circassian from Amman, Shamsuddin Sami, who is a Circassian from Salt, Sheikh Mithqal al-Fayyaz, who is the elected member of the Northern Tribal from Bani Safir, and Sheikh Hamid ibn Jazi from the Huitat, which is the Southern Tribe. What's interesting is we have members of the opposition who were theoretically boycotting the elections still are somehow elected to the Legislative Council. But their leader, Hussein al-Karrana, who was from Karak, and is elected as the president of the National Congress through his entire life, from 1928 to 1933, isn't elected. So we have oppositional figures, but we don't have the head of the opposition moving into the Legislative Council. The internal regulations of the Legislative Council, this is the actual Legislative Council building, which is rather plain and boring and gets torn down in the 60s. The internal regulations are very important because they are actually what determines what essentially the rules of engagement will be for the Legislative Council moving forward. Initially, the terms of the internal regulations, if they're kind of given to the Legislative Council, are said that only members of the Executive Council, so members of the cabinet or heads of departments, are the only ones who can introduce legislation. And not surprisingly, almost every single member of the Legislative Council is in opposition to this. They refer, Najib Abu Shahar, who is a Circassian, a Christian from Ajnun, says, "We are not minors and we are eager to work for independence." He also mentions that we should not be treated like children in Al-Qutar, that they are acknowledging that we are real people. We know these are not political neophytes. Many of them were judges or even part of Adi's government or parts of Faisal's government, short-lived government in Damascus. They know what they're arguing about. And they, through a number of sessions, keep arguing for, we need the right to introduce legislation. Otherwise, all we can do is vote up and down on something. Then that is not a representational government. And the major thing they keep bringing up is that's a right that Iraq has. So if you let Iraq have that right to introduce legislation, why not us? Despite all of that, they signed a petition by all, pretty much every member of the Legislative Council to send it to Abdullah saying, we need the rights to revise Articles 24, 25, and 26, giving us the right to introduce our own legislation. The Emir sends issues an Irada on April 25th, 1929, saying, no. That would be in opposition of the organic law and the mandate terms itself. We cannot give you this power. With no other alternative, the Legislative Council passes the internal regulations. So as early as they pass it literally the next day, April 26, 1929, the Legislative Council has been neutered. It no longer has the power to introduce their own authority. They've lost a degree of their sovereignty. But despite all that, the opposition does not fade away. It's not one and done, as some other historians have, Man Abu Nawar and Nasir Aruri have said. There is this one moment of opposition, it's in 1929, and then it's gone. That's not true. The Legislative Council goes on for years after this, and they continue to fight it for years after this. One other thing that is important to mention, so this is saying with the internal regulations, not the agreement itself yet. One of the major people who's fighting the strongest for the right to introduce legislation is a gentleman by the name of Alda Al-Qusus, who is from Karak. So I said, the people are going to be angrier, theoretically. And he's fighting for the right to have introduced legislation in the internal regulations. But he will then become the strongest proponent of the government for the agreement's passage. So you can't have these artificial divides of you had the opposition and everyone else. This is very much a discussion where there is lots of personal interest and the attempt to maintain and keep as much personal autonomy and personal influence as possible. The largest issue with the 1928 agreement isn't that it's an agreement from the British, isn't that it has colonial and imperial stamp. The biggest issue is that it was created without Transjordanian input. The British give it to Transjordan completely formed. It's given to Abdullah first in 1925, and there are no revisions done its entire existence. It's like manna from heaven. It's there, and it is done. Even though the members of the council go about a number of different ways to opposing the agreement, saying that the Arabic is wrong because it was translated poorly from English, that because it would acknowledge concession agreements, that it makes it wrong, that they had fear of Zionist incursion, and that's why we should reject it. They list a number of different things. But most notably, Najib Abu Shahar, the same person I mentioned referred to the school children, said that this agreement is not a verse from heaven and difficult to amend. There is no justification for obliging us to ratify simply because it was signed. So there is no reason we have to enter this agreement blindly. And Najib Abu Shahar is not an official member of the opposition. He did not sign the National Pact. He's not a member of the National Congress Party. oddly enough, out of the quote-unquote official members of the opposition and the people who are supposedly fighting against the agreement the strongest, only one of them really speaks during the proceedings, Shamsuddin Sami. Though he does speak the strongest, and he's the only member of the Legislative Council who wants to end the entire colonial system, he argues the acceptance of this agreement won't change any current position for us. Of course, it is said that to us, the acceptance of this agreement would render our temporary constitutional government a permanent one. But where is that constitutional government, and what is the meaning of constitution if we are accepting this agreement that would otherwise dispose us of the right of life? So Shamsuddin Sami does take this very strong view, and he's arguing, contrary to what the government and Al-Ghazal and other members have been saying, that if you don't pass this agreement, the Legislative Council will have no legal standing, that Transjordan will have a new legal standing, because you need the agreement for the mandate to actually be truly legal. Instead, what we see is other members of the council, Muhammad al-Unsi, Alauddin al-Tukan, Jiva Bushar, where they have opposition, but it's not opposition to a colonial system. They fully acknowledge the British should have control over the mandate. They fully acknowledge that Abdullah should be the monarch in charge of the mandate. What they disagree with is how that mandate will be structured and what their personal say in that issue will be. And they do so with full knowledge of parliamentary procedure, of the League of Nations. They mention the Treaty of Lausanne, the San Remo Conference. They mention every World War I kind of testament that you can think of is all mentioned in those proceedings. These are not, you know, neophytes that just assume they should have a say because they are tribal sheikhs. These are not ignorant Bedouin out of the desert. Far from it. And on the 14 members of the Legislative Council, so every elected member of the council, including Aldo Kosos, who is arguing for that we should just pass it, signed a petition to send to British resident Cox on May 30th, 1929, demanding the right to have amendments of the agreement. Unfortunately, that does not come to pass. The next day, British resident Cox sends a letter that is read by the Chief Minister, Hassan Khalid al-Huda, saying that they must take their decision without delay, and that there is no reason that this needs to be taking longer. At this point, they've already been debating for well over a month. Members of the council knew what this was. This was a veiled threat. If you don't make a decision soon, I will. This is important because this is exactly what happens in Iraq, where it was High Commissioner Percy Cox, no relation, at that point saying, you must pass the agreement or I will find another way to do so. Shortly thereafter, Sayyid al-Mufti acknowledges that this is as if a bomb was thrown into the council, that they needed to make a decision. And finally, with fear of not having any input whatsoever, that the council would be dissolved and there would be no representational aspect to the mandate, the Legislative Council does ratify the 1928 agreement on June 2nd, 1929. Hussein al-Tarnan, the same leader of the opposition, mentioned that this was a nightmare of arbitrary colonization and military occupation of our weak country. So after the signing of the pact, the terms of the agreement have been set. The terms of the mandate have been set. They know what, the Legislative Council is very much aware of what is and is not permissible at that point, but it does not end the opposition. So all of the agreement proceedings are all extraordinary sessions. The first official session of the Legislative Council is convened on November 5th, 1929. This is an image of Abdullah officially opening the council and gives a speech to open it and say, we're so happy we have representational government, etc. What you don't see are the over 200 people protesting the agreement. And these protests are from the opposition group, but they're also against Zionism, they're against the concession agreements, they're against imperial control, they're against everything except for the emir, which is important because to this day, almost all opposition in Jordan, there is this divide between the government and the monarchy. And somehow all of the criticism is always towards the government, separated from the monarchy. And that same model lasts throughout the mandate. with each legislative council after the first one. So the first legislative council will be officially dismissed in 1931 for not approving a budget. Every council thereafter, the powers of the legislative council diminish a bit, but that doesn't mean the opposition disappears. What we have instead is this period of exchange, where people who were formerly autonomous elites and notables throughout Transjordan give up a bit of their authority with each passing council, but it becomes more and more important for them to be part of the government. So instead of being an autonomous elite from Salt, you will now be a Transjordanian elite, but your seat at the table is guaranteed. And that's the true happening. That's the true impact and the true life of this afterwards. The opposition is not short-lived. It's just the terms of the opposition, the way in which it engages with the government, change with time. Thank you so much.
To fill the silence, I will just remind you that we'll now hear from Dónal, Hassett, who will be speaking on citizen soldiers or subject soldiers, the Indigenous veterans movement, and the quest for citizenship in interwar and Algeria.
Thank you very much. That's a hard act to follow, but I'm going to try and do my best. Before I start, I just think that I would turn to this Gingko leaf, which has been used to represent so many things differently in metaphors, and I'm going to throw another mixed metaphor into the pot and say that we can look at the Gingko leaf as a representation of the Middle East and its relationship with North Africa, because they're both kind of separate, but part of the one thing. And I think up until this point, there hasn't been much discussion of the Maghreb, in which I can see lots of similarities with things that you were talking about and then things that were radically different. So I'm sure that will make for an interesting discussion afterwards. So, in mid-September 1913, a group of Algerian Muslim veterans of the Great War gathered in the city of Oran for the inaugural congress of the recently founded League of Muslim Veterans of the Amany. This first foray into organized claims-making by an indigenous-only group of veterans occurred in the midst of the official celebrations of the centenary of the French invasion of Algeria. As the colonial authorities fated the progress made under French rule and commemorated military victories of the Army of Africa, both in the campaign of conquest and in the more recent battles of the Great War, the indigenous veterans issued a simple but powerful call for reform. Let the centenary not disappoint the hopes which are born in us. Let it consecrate the indissoluble union of the victors of the Great War and translate this fraternity into concrete measures in line with our aspirations. Over the course of the following decade, indigenous veterans across Algeria would seek to promote a wide range of claims for financial, social, and above all, political equality, using collective action to push for the reforms that could transform rhetoric into reality. The tactics varied, as did the claims they pursued, but what united the disparate indigenous veterans movement that emerged in the Algeria of the 1930s was the desire for integration into a new form of imperial citizenship. Their case, this paper argues, shows how the political legacies of the Great War, as felt by those Algerians who had participated in it, are not only, or even primarily, to be understood in terms of nationalism, but can be found in an ultimately doomed attempt to make real the rhetoric of fraternity born in the trenches. The organizations of indigenous veterans that emerged in the period sought to use the symbolic capital participation in the war had bestowed on them to push not for an independent Algeria, but rather for a position of differentiated equality within the French imperial structure. So before I delve into a detailed analysis of the veterans movement in Algeria, I might just refresh your knowledge about Algeria's experience of the Great War. So for the inhabitants of Algeria, the Great War began closer to home than anyone could have imagined. In the early morning of August 4th, 1914, just hours after the declaration of war, the Algerian port cities of Beaune and Philippeville, now known as Annaba and Skikta, came under heavy shelling from the German cruisers, the Goeben and the Breslau. The attacks, which left 17 dead and scores injured, marked the first non-aerial assault on a French territory during the war. Although Algeria would never again be directly targeted, Thousands of our inhabitants would lose their lives on the battlefields of Europe. Over the course of the war, 73,000 of the European or settler community served as French citizens on the front. In total, some 173,000 Indigenous soldiers had served in French forces by the end of the war, with slightly more than half of these enlisting as volunteers, though this term is questionable given the recruitment practices employed by colonial administrators. Of the Indigenous contingent, 125,000 saw active duty on the battlefields. Estimates for European dead range between 12 and 22,000, while the number of Indigenous dead is normally put somewhere around 26,000. Furthermore, thousands of Indigenous workers took up positions in factories in France, freeing up men to serve at the front and playing an important role in maintaining essential supply of military and industrial equipment. On the home front, the war in Algeria saw the acceleration of processes of urbanisation and industrialisation that were to have a transformative effect on the country in the interwar period. As in Europe, the end of the war in the colonies was marked not only by celebration and commemoration, but also by contestation and claims making. Pointing to the promises made during the war by political and military leaders, political actors across all ethnic and ideological divides called for some form of compensation for the horrors they had endured in the defence of the Atlantic. In the colonial metropoles, the demand for recompense came mainly in the form of social claims, the hope for better living standards and working conditions. These concerns were by no means absent in the colonies. However, in the empire, it was the nature of the relationship between colony and metropole that proved the key political issue. The deeply rooted republican concept of the impôt du sang, or blood tax, had, since the advent of the French Revolution, established an almost sacred correlation between military service, and particularly conscription, and citizenship. It was to this idea that the proponents of Indigenous reform would turn in the wake of the Great War. Veterans, of course, had a special claim to the symbolic capital of the war, and it is no coincidence that the leader, the campaign for Indigenous reform in the immediate aftermath of the war, the Emir Khaled, was a decorated veteran of the Great War. While the Emir, grandson of the famous Algerian resistance leader, Adel Kader, often evoked the important communal contribution to the war made by Algerian Muslims, his campaign for granting full political rights to the Indigenous population was largely confined to the educated elites, and only sought belatedly and with very little success to mobilise non-elite interest groups. The Emir's campaign would not result in a radical transformation of the condition of the Indigenous population, but his stress on the need for the extension of citizenship to the Indigenous elite without impinging on their legal status as Muslims subject to Quranic law would deeply shape Indigenous claims across the interwar period. The imperial precedent set by Blaise Diagne's successful campaign during the Great War for the naturalization of the inhabitants of Senegal's four communes within their personal status as Muslims held out the prospect for a new form of imperial citizenship that could reconcile the practice of Islam and the Republic. This would remain the central goal of Indigenous reformers throughout most of the interwar period. For their part, Algerian Muslim veterans, preoccupied with the difficult task of reintegrating back into society, did not emerge as a significant presence on the political scene in the immediate aftermath of the war. The same could not be said, however, for the veterans of the European community. They moved quickly to found veterans groups to defend their rights. And here we see membership for the one of the largest and most important European veterans groups, the Amicales des Mutuelles des Anciens Combattants, which eventually would very early permitted Indigenous members to join and becomes a key veterans movement in Algeria in this period. So initially the colonial authorities devolved control of the Indigenous veterans to veterans associations such as the Amicales. In the 20s, these cross-community organisations, dominated by a European leadership, seemed to meet success in channeling the energies of Indigenous veterans away from dangerous political agitation and into a very restricted form of claims making. They offered a limited forum in which Indigenous veterans could denounce the most flagrant economic inequalities that define the pensions regime. The European cadre of the transcommunal organisations were more than happy to pay lip service to demands for economic and social improvements that in no way threatened European hegemony, co-opting Indigenous claims into a wider denunciation of the state's failure to pay its dues to those who had fought to save it. 1930 marked a turning point for Algeria's Indigenous veterans. The introduction of the retraite du combattant, which you can see here, a small but not insignificant pension for all veterans who had served at least 3 months at the front, at equal rates for veterans from Algeria's European and Indigenous communities, simultaneously empowered Indigenous veterans financially and reinforced their claim to equality. In parallel, the pomp and ceremony that surrounded the centenary celebrations served to crystallize the malaise of the Indigenous community, marking the onset of the mass politics of contestation of the existing colonial system. It was in this context that Indigenous veterans first undertook collective action. Conscious of the growing unease of Indigenous veterans, the leadership of the cross-community organizations sought to preempt any rebellion by moving away from the earlier tokenistic endorsement of Indigenous claims towards a more vocal and proactive campaign in favor of economic and social demands of their former comrades in arms. However, the Indigenous Veterans Platform was soon to extend beyond calls for the reform of pensions and allocations. Months after the Interfederal Congress of Cross-Community Associations appealed for an improvement of the conditions of Indigenous veterans, the League of Muslim Veterans of the OME made a clear and concise call for a political reform that would see veterans accede to an imperial citizenship, a formula which would respect their personal status as Muslims while granting them the rights to which their participation in the war entitled them. And I quote, "Those who survived the war thought that, given their sacrifice for the ideal of liberty, they would be free from all measures of exception. But this was not the case. The veterans note that regardless of their degree of evolution, regardless of their worthiness, they remain submitted to the regime, and their battle wounds have only served to prepare them for an early grave. It is in order to put an end to this situation, which seems to them incompatible with their sacrifice and with the very essence of Republican principles, that they demand the right to citizenship." Arguing that French policy towards Indigenous veterans represented a betrayal of the very essence of Republican principles, the League was mobilizing the contradictions at the heart of the French imperial project against their colonial masters. If Algeria truly was the North African extension of the metropole, then surely her sons who fought in the battlefields of Europe in defense of the patrie should enjoy the same rights as their European brothers in arms. While the veterans of Oran blazed a trail for subsequent groups across the colonies, the forums provided by the cross-community organizations still seemed to represent to most Indigenous veterans the best chance for advancing their cause. In the wake of the policy changes of 1930, trans-communal veterans organizations began to offer much more time and space for Indigenous veterans' issues. Although still dominated by the European community, the administrative bodies and newspaper columns of the organization were gradually opening up to Indigenous veterans. And here we can see the prime example. Tahar Awidat, a school teacher, veteran, and a naturalized French citizen, became a key expert for the Amicale on Indigenous issues, serving in prominent positions on committees and writing combative articles in newspapers. Indigenous veterans also spoke out at public meetings, confronting the European leadership with demands for action on the inequalities they faced and calling for an endorsement of political reform. In 1934, at the Fourth Trimester General Assembly of the Amicale, a strong Indigenous attendance insisted on special attention for their demands, with one of their number, Ali Handad, addressing the Assembly. The response of the Amicale's president, Joseph Kel-David, was telling, and I quote, "Kel-David highlighted the delicate nature of demands surrounding the status of the Indigenous, but committed himself to defending energetically all the questions of moral or material order that concern victims of war. Hostile to supporting a political project which was probably anathema to its European membership, the Amicale sought to placate Indigenous veterans by endorsing, for the first time, total equality of pension rights. For the cross-community organisations, the endorsement of financial equality by no means implied any commitment to political equality. Faced with the European-dominated veterans movement that refused to support political reforms which threatened their hegemony in the colony's racially structured system of rule, Indigenous veterans increasingly turned towards the Indigenous press to voice their frustration. In July 1934, an article appeared in La Défense, a newspaper close to the Islamic reform movement, the Association of Algerian Ulema, expressing the discontent of Indigenous veterans with wider political situation in Algeria. The author, identified only by the initials MSL and by his service as a, I quote, volunteer soldier and war amputee, constructed an argument around the Republican trope of the blood tax, asserting that participation in the war granted the Indigenous an inalienable right to citizenship. And I quote, In the constitution of the modern state, where the defense of the soil is the duty of all the people, the blood tax remains the true criterion for distinguishing nationals from foreigners. The fact that the indigenous Algerian has been submitted to obligatory conscription and has borne the weight of military duties gives him, regardless of the lack of legislative text, the moral right to consider himself a Frenchman. End of quote. Furthermore, he contended that this call for citizenship could only be achieved as part of a wider social and political movement, requiring indigenous veterans to organize and ally with existing political groups. And I quote, "In the movement for emancipation, which is violently shaking our populations, the indigenous, in order to obtain social and economic political improvements, struggled, and justifiably so, to reap the rewards of the duties they carried out, primarily the military duty that they fulfilled in the dark hours of the Great Massacre. In this vision, transcommunal veterans organizations had all but disappeared. If indigenous veterans wanted to promote their agenda, they would have to take their own future, and that of their community, into their own hands. This would mean forming their own organizations. Thus, a phenomenon which had previously been restricted to the city of Oran now spread across the colony. In November 1935, the newly formed Ligue des Combattants et Victimes de Guerre Indigènes d'Algérie, a group based in Kabylia, put forward its program in the indigenous press. They quite pointedly asserted the right of indigenous veterans associations to engage in political campaigns, while also implicitly attacking the limited program of the cross-community veterans associations. I quote, "By offering himself as a sacrifice for the safeguarding of national integrity, the indigenous soldier was within his rights to count on, once peace arrived, an era of real fraternity and honesty, compatible with the evolution of Muslim Algeria. Now they are shocked that our action is not limited to soliciting medals, subventions, cafe licenses, and other favors of minimal importance, and that we have the pretension to aim higher and further than certain demands that can be immediately satisfied. This refusal to restrict the agenda of the veterans movement to those issues directly concerning veterans alone was at odds with the program pursued by cross-community groups. Political rights now lay at the heart of the Indigenous Veterans Platform. For the proponents of Indigenous reform in Algeria, the election of the Popular Front in 1936 seemed to offer the prospect of transforming the system of colonial rule. For the first time, the governing coalition in the metropole contained elements committed to serious reform in the colonies. In Algeria, the alliance of the forces of the left and the movements for indigenous reform resulted in the modest Blume Violet proposal. It's named after Léon Blume, the Prime Minister, and Moïse Violet, who was the General of Algeria previously and was appointed to organize reform in Algeria. This proposal, which, if implemented, would have assimilated 21,000 indigenous without requiring them to renounce their personal legal status as Muslims. The special categories favored by this project included degree holders and certain, but not all, veterans. The prospective reform posed a dilemma to the indigenous veterans. On the one hand, the failure to include all veterans within its scope constituted a challenge to the veterans' claim to primacy in post-war society. On the other, the provisions of the project represented an essential breach in the boundary between citizenship and subjecthood, allowing for the first time in Algeria for naturalization within the personal status. In the end, the radical indigenous veterans movement opted to support the project, while their rival to the cross-community organization continued to call for the primacy of the veteran. In light of their endorsement of the Blume Violet project, the more radical indigenous veterans movements became part of the Congrès Musulman, a wider coalition of civil society and political organizations supporting the Popular Front. The Congrès included the veterans as one of the special interest groups represented on its committees. Bakir Ben Kalaida, a war amputee and vice president of the Association of Muslim Veterans of the Department of Constantine, represented the veterans in the Congrès delegation to the Popular Front government of Paris. Many indigenous veterans organizations worked closely with political leaders of indigenous reform movements, coordinating activities, and even participating in electoral campaigns. At a grassroots level, they proved to be a key organizational asset to the broader movement of the Congrès, mobilizing men of a certain prestige and influence to rally the mass of the indigenous population behind the project. The close links developed by indigenous veterans movements with political organizations promoting reform was just one strategy pursued with the aim of securing political rights for both their members and the Indigenous community as a whole. Another approach was to use their position in the umbrella organisations of the Veterans Associations in North Africa to push a far more radical programme than that envisaged by their comrades and or competitors in the cross-community organisations. In March 1937, Nuruddin Abdullah, leader of Oran's Muslim veterans, organised a congress in the city drawing together the Indigenous veterans movements from across the Maghreb. Delegates from across Algeria spoke out against government neglect and demanded full support for the Blue Violet project. Months later, at the Interfederal Congress in Casablanca, Algeria's Indigenous veterans movements presented a united front, blocking an attempt by the Amicale to have its policy regarding the Blue Violet project adopted universally. The Indigenous veterans wanted an unambiguous endorsement of the scheme, asserting that the Amicale's policy of non-committal put, and I quote, obstacles in the way of a project they very much supported. At the following year's Interfederal Congress in Algiers, the question of Indigenous rights would once again prove extremely problematic. Tasked by the Congress with reporting on the Indigenous question, Tahar Awidaz was harshly critical of the government's neglect of Indigenous veterans, comparing their fate, the fate of their claims, to that of the Rock of Sisyphus. This rhetoric notwithstanding, Awidaz remained committed to the moderate agenda of the Amicale, stopping short of any endorsement of the Blue Violet project and presenting a motion calling for priority for veterans in reform plans. The leaders of more radical Indigenous veterans movements were not willing to rubber stamp this extension of the Amicale's long-standing policy to the Interfederation as a whole. Once more, Nuruddin challenged the cautious agenda dictated by the cross-community organisations, declaring himself willing to temporarily renounce his claim to citizenship rights to support the provisions of Blue Violet, a statement that provoked agitation in the audience. His colleague from Constantine, Bakir Rekalaya, called for a motion of approval of the Popular Front and the rejection of Awidaz's proposition. According to the official report of the Congress, an extensive discussion ensued. Speaking on behalf of the cross-community organisation, the Amicale president, Kaola Leet, articulated the rejection of the endorsement of the Blue Violet in terms of the primacy of the veteran, and I quote, "If we have thought of demanding electoral rights in favour of our comrades, it is because we believe, we veterans, who had them by our sides during the war, that even those who live in hovels in the most distant villages, who may be the most ignorant, have a right to priority over the others, even those who have a higher education. The Indigenous veteran shed his blood for France, with us and for us. He is a Frenchman." Pierre David's next comment offered an insight into another, undoubtedly more important reason for his reticence to commit the Amicale and the Interfederation to support for the project. I quote, "Respectful of all opinions, because the Interfederation includes comrades of diverse political opinions, we cannot support one project or another. Unwilling and unable to rally the majority of his members to support a project that was roundly rejected by most of the European-led political movements in Algeria, Kel David and the Amicale pushed for the adoption of a motion calling for priority to be given to veterans in any reform of the political status of the Indigenous. The Amicale's policy was approved, with your official Congress booklet reporting. The motion was adopted unanimously, except for three votes," which is quite an interesting definition of unanimous. "The Amicale had imposed its agenda, but had not succeeded in convincing the Indigenous naysayers. In the end, the failure of the Popular Front to invest the necessary political capital in the adoption of the Blue Violet project would mean that by the time the government fell, little progress had been made towards fundamental reform in Algeria. The Popular Front's inertia led to the collapse of the alliance of moderate political forces, the radical left, Islamists, reformists, and civil society that had formed the Congrès Musulman. Charismatic Massali Hadj and his dynamic Parti du Peuple Algérien, only present in Algeria as a significant political force since 1936, moved in to fill the gap, winning vast swathes of the indigenous masses over to the cause of nationalism. The idea of some form of national independence was displacing the notion of a differentiated form of citizenship within the empire. The advent of Vichy rule in Algeria would see the dissolution of veterans' movements and the formation of a single regime approved organisation that left little room for political debate. The political assertiveness of the indigenous veterans of the late 30s was stifled in the repressive atmosphere of Pétain's Algeria, their voice no longer posing a threat to European hegemony. And yet, for a decade, The Indigenous veterans of Algeria constituted a powerful lobby for political reform. They challenged European hegemony both within the veteran movement itself and within wider colonial society. While the former struggle met with considerable success, as European-led cross-community organizations no longer held the monopoly over representation of veterans by the end of the 1930s, the latter proved more problematic. Drawing heavily on the French tradition of the blood tax, pointing to the imperial precedent set by the 1915 naturalization in Senegal, the veterans demanded incorporation into the privileges of citizenship while also underlining their commitment to their own religion and culture by refusing to renounce their legal status as Muslims. The language they mobilized had little to do with Wilsonian concepts of self-determination, Leninist notions of nationality policy, or pan-Islamist appeals to the internal Ummah. Rather, Indigenous veterans recognized the potency of their particular claim to political rights and framed this claim in the long-established language of French republicanism, which tied citizenship to military service. Thus, the war provided a source of legitimacy that could undermine colonial domination from within, with the goal of collective emancipation to be achieved through imperial citizenship, not national liberation. So to conclude, the story of these Indigenous veterans shows that, at least in Algeria, contestation of the system of imperial rule in the aftermath of the Great War was not confined to radical nationalists or communists, but could also be found among those who proclaimed their loyalty to France and demanded only that she return the favour by welcoming them fully into the national community. Indeed, we could say that the legacy of the Great War in Algeria lies not so much in the rise of nationalism, but rather in the rise of contestatory mass politics. It would be the French colonial state's inherent unwillingness and inability to respond to this that would lead, in part, to the embrace of nationalist politics. Thank you.
And our third and final speaker today will be Amany Soliman, who will be looking at the rise of Egyptian nationalism and the perception of foreigners in Egypt between 1914 and 1923.
Good evening. I know how these after-lunch sessions are hard, so I'll try to be fast and to the point. So today I'm trying to talk about the Egyptian nationalism and the one of the defining periods of the Egyptian history that starts from the 1914, of course, the start of the Great War, taking us to the 1919 revolution or uprising, however technical political science term is, and then all the kind of negotiations that started from 1919 to 1920, and then the first constitution of an independent Egypt in 1923. The perception of foreigners in Egypt, especially in the last quarter of the 19th century, was totally occupied by what was called the Alexandria Massacre. The Alexandria Massacre took place in June 1882, when a fight between an Egyptian white man who had a customer, a Maltese customer, they did not agree on the fees they wanted from the Maltese. They engaged in fight, then other Egyptians engaged with the Egyptian, other foreigners, Greeks and others engaged with the Maltese, and in the end of the day, we don't have accurate numbers, but at least 600 Egyptians and around 100 foreigners were killed. And by coincidence, the British battleships were in the east of the Mediterranean, near the coast, and immediately a statement was declared that the foreigners in Egypt are under major threats and the British should intervene to protect the minorities, whether Egyptians or non-Egyptians. In a matter of less than 1 month, specifically on the 14th of July, the bombardment of Alexandria started. The city was almost destroyed by that once was the burden of the Mediterranean. It was destroyed in 3 days by the British gunfires. And from this moment on, the Egyptians started to think that the British has been indebted the country for more than 15 years, but they only had a footstep depending on the massacre, depending on the claim of protecting the foreigners. And this is what we had from accepting the foreigners between us. Actually, these foreigners came to Egypt and their numbers increased on four main ways. The first one was during Muhammad Ali's reign, when they came trying to make use of both the capitulations plus the exemptions he made from taxes and for new investors, especially in Alexandria. They came in major numbers, and mostly these were wealthy Europeans, especially French and Greeks. Then another wave came in the 1960s and 70s, and these were mainly two groups. The first group, again Europeans, who came to make advantage of the economic flourish with the Suez Canal opening, as well as Syrians and Levantines who came to Egypt fleeing the settled tension in Mount Lebanon, in Jerusalem, and there were many of them were Maronites and Jews as well, and they flourished the cultural and actually I think that they have established what is modern press in Egypt now, including even Al-Ahram, the most prominent Egyptian newspaper. The third wave was with the British occupation, and when the British occupation ruled the country, they made major agrarian and irrigational reforms, which increased the harvest of the or the production of cotton, and it just made it very appealing to the European merchants to come to Egypt. And the last wave, in between 1914 and 1917, was a wave of refugees. Thousands of refugees fled the east of the Mediterranean, coming to Egypt, and these were mainly poor, prohibited from everything, even some came to Egypt without their shoes. There were Levantines, there were Jews, Armenians, and even some people from East Europe and the Balkans, and the numbers are vast, and they are not really well archived, as well as there is another problem, and I talked about in Dr. Fawaz's session. Many of them, when they entered Egypt, they registered themselves under another identity, either to hide themselves and their families, or to make use of a capitulation of a stronger community. In my paper, when I'm talking about foreigners, I'm going to exclude the British, because I don't want to mix the negative feelings that the Egyptians had for the British occupation with any other negative feeling they would have towards any other kind of foreigners. Also, most of the Egyptians who have done studies like these, they have made two categories, like the Arab residents, like the Syrians and the Moroccans, and then another for the Europeans and the Americans. And I will not do this. Foreigners here applies to whoever was not granted an Egyptian citizenship when 1914 events erupted. Also, in my paper, it would look more to the negative side of the relation between the Egyptian and the foreigners. And my reason for that is, we have a very dreamy coverage for this period in the Arabic literature, and every time it's talking about cosmopolitanism and how forgiving and tolerant was everyone to another, which I do not deny, but it's over dreamy, it's very idealistic, and I don't really believe that understanding our history is by concealing the parts we don't like. So, given the fact that many of the other professors or the major professors in Egyptian universities and elsewhere have covered the good sides, I will try to bring the not very amusing ones. The numbers of foreigners in Egypt in the last two census before the time I'm trying to engage with, in 1907 census, 2% of the population, which was 11.2 million people, were foreigners. Greeks were the biggest group, and actually it's always estimated that from the start of the 20th century, the Greeks made 30 to 35% of the foreign community in Egypt, and most of them were inhabitants of Alexandria. Then came the Italians and the French and other European and US residents weren't really that much. In 1917 census, the number dropped to 1%, and it's obvious in the other census, which had more subcategories, it was done by the Egyptian government or Egyptian government and the British administration, the number of the Armenians, because they were not, it was not right any longer to put them just in one category with other nationalities or other residents. It was, the number was getting bigger. However, again, the numbers are not accurate because it depends on how someone is identifying themselves, and most of them did not, especially the refugees, they did not have any official records of where they came from. The word that the Egyptians used to, until now, to call the foreigner is khawaja, and even the Syrians or the Levantines who were not Muslims were called the same word. So khawaja means someone who is not ibn al-balad, son of the country, and it was applied even on Arabs who were not Muslims. The presence of the Greeks was the most noticeable, and even Lord Cromer in his book about Egypt, he said that whenever you move a stone in Egypt, you will find a Greek underneath. And some Egyptian early nationalists, they started talking about how the foreigners are an obstacle in the face of Egypt towards achieving independence, towards the rise of Egyptian nationalism. In his book, The Economic Remedy for Egypt and the Idea of Bank Masr, the national, the Bank of Egypt, Dónal wrote in late 1913 that, as you can read, I quote, it's all about the foreigners. He says that this country is full of fortune, but how come that only the ones who are coming from other countries are capable of making use of them? And they are making themselves rich by embarrassing this country. Also, before the war, someone was considered one of the godmothers of Egyptian education, especially of women, who was Nabawiya Musa. She wrote that she doesn't like the idea of missionary schools increasing in Egypt because she thinks that they are polluting the minds of the Egyptian girls with ideas that is not theirs, with ethics that doesn't belong to their culture, and she is really worried about the increasing number of these schools, and she wants a strong Egyptian government that can really put them under surveillance and control and give them curriculum that would respect the culture of the country they are in. During the Great War, the first signs of worry was, of course, of the German and Austrians who started to leave Egypt as early as in August 19. Some of them were heading towards Turkey and from Turkey to Europe, but some others were, there were, a German ship that was sent to them when they went to Trieste in Italy, and from Italy to Austria. The numbers dropped from 1850 to only 257 German, and the Austrians from 7,700 to 2,800. And the explanation here was that Yunana Rivers said so, that the Austrians were controlling the business of hotels in Egypt. And they said that they will stay in Egypt and take the risk because the war, which was going to erupt, will bring a lot of foreigners, diplomats, all kind of people to the country. And they don't want to lose the money they have already invested in this industry. It was a very risky game, but most of the time they kept a very low profile, and most of the times they even claimed that they belonged to other nationalities. One of the most prominent Germans who left Egypt back then, and he wrote that it really was a heartbreak, it was Shada. He was the chief librarian of the Khedivian library, and also two of the vice consuls of Austria, then followed by the consul himself. Tensions and accusations were loud during the war. In Al-Ahram report entitled, "Is He a Spy?" it covered a story that an Egyptian man went with the weirdest case to the police station, saying that he had suspicions about his Armenian neighbor because he thinks that this Armenian is a spy for the Turks. And when the people started to mock him in the police station, he said, "No, I think that he's the Young Turkey, and this is why he is taking advantage of being Armenian to spy on the British forces in Egypt." The police took both of them to court, and there was a historic verdict that the judge said that no one is allowed to accuse anyone of being a spy or saying such accusations this way. He acquitted the Armenian and fined the Egyptian 20 pounds, which was a huge amount of money back then, and he made like a public statement that was published in Al-Ahram about how neighbors should stay strongly bonded in times of uncertainty. There was also a German raid on Cairo on November 13, 1916, and 20 people were killed. This air raid was the only one on Egypt on that day, and the proof that the foreigners were everywhere in Cairo, that this air raid was against the east and the north of Cairo, which are middle-class and low-class neighborhoods. Yet, out of the 20 killed, there were 8 foreigners. These foreigners were Greeks, Armenians, and Jewish Balkan foreigners. So it was very obvious that sometimes we get the perception that most of the foreigners who lived in Egypt were wealthy people like Bashes and Bis, which is not true. You bomb Bulak and you find a Greek killed there. E.F. Forster, the known British novelist, he visited Egypt and wrote a book called Salute to Egypt in 1916. And he said that he never felt threatened in Egypt, and he doesn't believe what the British press is reporting about the tension against the foreigners in Egypt. And he says that, "I know that this tension is against occupations, it's against the rude Anzac soldiers, it's not against anyone else." And the proof is that he walked alone, he went to the native quarters and towns, he went to both Cairo and Alexandria and Suez, and he even entered mosques, and he never felt that he was threatened or unwelcomed. Egyptian satirical newspapers like El Masamir, The Nails, it started to publish Zagal. Zagal is like poems, comedian light, rhymed pieces. And one of them that did not have a title was called Mal'un Abu Sa'adtak. It's literally it's like God's curse be on your excellency. So it's him, he's targeting the Haga. He's saying that he is okay with the Bey, the Basha, and the Khawaja, having the money, having everything, but at least respect me as much as I respect you. What is annoying though, O Bey, Basha, or Khawaja, is that I am a man like you. So it's not about, I'm okay that I don't have independence, I'm okay that you're having all the money, but at least give me my dignity back. Another Zagal with Muhammad Abdul Rasul, also in El Masamir on Jan 11, just a couple, the WEF was already formed in late 1918, but it wasn't imprisoned by the deported by the British, exiled by the British yet. It's called "Oh Nile, I Love You," and then he goes to list those who are exploiting the Egyptian peasant, and he names Yenni and Sadah. Yenni is weak, Sadah is 11 times. So again, he's referring to the source of evil in the country, those who are taking the fortunes of the Egyptian are these two categories. Why always the Greeks? Actually, the Greeks, called the Greek or Arwam, they were in every single sector of business in the country. They controlled the cotton stock market in Alexandria, which was one of, if not the biggest in the world. And there are even categories of cotton still named after a Greek expert until today in Egypt. And 35% of all shares, all stocks in all sectors, all banks were, did belong to Greeks. On the other hand, some of them were kontargeia. Kontargeia means shoemakers, and actually, especially in Alexandria today, when you go to a shoe shop and you ask for a certain size, the vendors talk to each other in Greek, like in the numbers of the sizes of the shoes are still said in Greek. Some of them are, the most prominent job they had were ba'alim, which is grocery sellers. And it's a very known thing in the Egyptian cinema from the 30s and 40s, even the 50s, and the novels and the plays, to find the Greek who is, whose colloquial Egyptian Arabic is not very perfect, selling you pastirma and cheese and kalamata olives. Also, one of the unweird scenes in Egypt was that the Greeks are the ones who were very involved in establishing trade unions, syndicates in Egypt. Some of the earliest communists in Egypt were Greeks. And a lot of the Egyptians back then, they would tell you stories about Ahawi coffee shops in downtown Alexandria or Cairo, where you find an Egyptian worker sitting with a Greek and a Jewish communist, and they are all talking about how this country is becoming absorbed by the rich. And the rich here applies on everyone, whether Egyptian or not Egyptian. However, in other narratives, the Greeks were always accused of being the masters of Ashuri riba and gambling in Egypt. And they say that they did not really work, they were just waiting for the Egyptians to make money and then take it away from them. Sayyid Darwish, who was called the artist of the people, and he had he moved Zagel from just being printed in newspaper all the way to being songs that were easily passed from one mouth to another. These words were written by Yunus al-Adi, but he made them in a song, the Kutra song. The Kutra means the too much. And he's mocking it like Egypt has too much, but we don't see any of it. And it's again, it's talking about how the foreigners not only sharing the Nile water with us, but they made a company that is regulating the use of water, making you, Egyptian, paying money to them to drink from the Nile. And even if you wanted to walk in the streets or move from one point or another, you have to use the tramways of Khawaja Kiryani, again, a Greek. So our pockets are clean and our house is even cleaner, and the clothes we are wearing are already boned. And by the way, so some of the translations of these cycles are from Ziad Fahmi's PhD, which was in Oxford, about how the colloquial Egyptian evolved the rise of Egyptian nationalism. Some I did the translation and some he did. Nagiba Rahani, or Kishkish Bey, is a very known character. Kishkish Bey is an Egyptian peasant from the Nile Delta. He's illiterate, he's very naive. He made loads of money from the wartime, from selling his cotton. But Kishkish Bey has this habit. Every time he makes money, he goes to Cairo to spend the money in a bar or a cabaret. And in every single play of these, the one who's making use of him is either a Greek, Armenian, or a Jew. He's manipulating the naive Kishkish. And this is the play Ish. It was by Orwau. It was written by, the songs written by Yunus Al-Adi, and again the music by Sayed Darwish. And it starts with Kharalambo. Kharalambo was just an invented Egyptian name to refer to a Greek person. And he says that once he saw that my bucket was full, he immediately stood still. His eyes were on my farmland. He told me, let's play John Walker, make me drink John Walker. I played, got drink, and lost until I fell into Abbeys. And again, he just, every time he goes to Cairo, the Greeks make him sell whatever he made for the past couple of months. Again, the battle for women's awakening in Egypt was parallel to the battle for independence. So a lot of Egyptian women started to write open letters to Egyptian newspapers in different languages, asking for their rights, mainly signing with their only first name or their initials. So this is from Abul Hol newspaper, the Sphinx newspaper, that had a lot of these debates between pro and anti women's rights. And it says here, the voices of the European women and the Oriental women's awakening, and there is a subtitle about the idiocy of a westernized myth. So it's talking about how that the women are not asking for their rights, they just like the model they have seen in the foreign families they visit. And it even has like advices to men, do not let your daughter or your wife or your mother be near any foreign woman because she's just going to sabotage her ethics. Sorry. Again, a couple of weeks before the revolution, there is another saga by Muhammad Abdul Rasul. It's like a dialogue between a father and his daughter, and the daughter is Hind, and the father, he thinks that all the problems he is having with his daughter is because of a dress. Oh, Hind, if you want to go out, it's better to be the Kutab, the Quran school. So she replies, Daddy, my mom accepted that I go to a Khawagaya tailor, and she will design me a dress for that reveals a lot. It should have a lot of sparkle and embroidery. And he gets back to her until, in the end, he said that the dress caused that his daughter is now riding a bike in the streets of the alley, and all the men of the alley are mocking him, and it all started with the dress made by the Khawagaya. When the Egyptian WAP was formed in late 1918, it was Saad Zaghloul and many of his comrades who just asked it as people representatives to go to a Versailles conference and ask for Egypt independence. And when the British exiled Zaghloul and two of his delegation members, the riots erupted in the country. One of the eyewitnesses to these events was Abdul Wahab al-Nagar. He was a very modernist sheikh of Al-Azhar. He wrote a very important book based on his diary that he was recording the events day by day, called The Red Days. He said that the violence started immediately the first day against the shops of the foreigners. He said that he has seen it himself, that the first thing happened ever was attacking the shops of the foreigners. But he said that he saw very poor people doing this, mobs in the streets, and he said that it was poor from all realms, even Jewish poor people were taking part in these looting incidents. He wrote The diaries were published in the early 1930s, but he claims that he wrote this on the first day of the riots, that the British tried to make a rift between the Egyptian Muslims and the Christian Muslims, but when they couldn't, they tried to replicate the scenario of 1882 by making the foreigners worry about their lives and their properties, so they don't look to in the eyes of the West that they are depriving the Egyptians from the rights, but they are just worried about foreigners. And I don't know if he really realized this by this time, or it was something that came up afterwards. But he also said that following this event on the second day, on March 8, 1919, the students who led the revolution made a statement assuring the foreigners for their safety, the safety of their property. They translated to different languages, and they met like a small delegation going from one consulate to another, from one embassy to another, saying that Egypt is looking for its independence, and it's not something that is against you. Many of the foreigners were many of the foreigners were pro the revolution, and they supported the Egyptians, and some of them, as you can see the names, the teachers and journalists were even deported from Egypt due to their support of the Egyptian revolt. Also, some of the French supported. The consul refused his the orders coming from Paris to terminate all the affairs, and he replied that he doesn't feel that it is against the foreigners, it's just against the British. The worst episode of all these events was the fierce clashes that started between the Armenians and the Egyptians, and there's something that is not really understandable in this, because it all started in Abdin on April 3rd with a man, an Armenian man, standing in the window of his house, and he just opened fire randomly on the protesters. They came up to his house and they killed him. Then another did the same from a music kiosk in that same place. And some people take this to support that the British tried to convince the Armenians that these protesters are pro-ban Islamic ideology, and they want to bring something like caliphate to Egypt, start a new caliphate from Cairo, and that would mainly target you, the Armenians, in revenge for, or in continuation for what the Ottomans did to you. There were a series of clashes, and it's reported that at least 20 Egyptians died, and 4 or 5 Armenians were killed, and the British forces used to take both the Egyptian and the Armenian sides of the clash, but always putting the Armenians away from the same city, from the city where the clash happened. Like if something happened in Bani Suif, they took them for a court in Cairo. Something happened in Bursa'id, they take them to Alexandria, and so on, just to avoid the escalating of violence. The Armenian patriarch sent a message to Wilson on the 8th of April, saying that we are being mass killed in the same Turkish way all over again. And the Greeks took refuge in their consulates in Alexandria and in Cairo, saying that some Egyptians are not really aware who the Armenians is and who the Armenian is and who the Greek is, and so far they are targeting all of us in the streets. And then a delegation from the Greeks, the Armenians, and the Jews tried to go to Azhar and convince everyone that civil peace should be maintained. El Masamir, which, as we have seen, was always mocking the foreigners, had to issue on its first page a message to assure the foreigners, it's one country, we are bonded, we are brothers, we have been living together for decades. And it was a very long message, actually, and it was like washing hands from what they have put before. And even Muhammad Abdul Nabi, who made all these zagas mocking the Khawaja, he made one Muslim, Copts, or Greeks, Jews, or Armenians, we are long time brothers, blah, blah, blah. The hamamil again. The first massacre that happened in 1882 was in a place in Alexandria called Al Hamamil. So in 1921, again in Al Hamamil, for different reasons, a fierce clash started between Egyptians from one side, Armenians and Greeks from the other side. The claim is that the Egyptians were raising the pictures or posters with the name of Ataturk. And when the Armenians and the Turks saw this, they got furious, they engaged in a verbal fight, and then it escalated. 43 Egyptians were killed, 15 foreigners were killed. Churchill immediately made a statement that this is why we shouldn't leave Egypt, because the foreigners are threatened in Egypt, it's happening all over again. The Egyptian press replied, it's not a coincidence that it happens, the conspiracy theory, it's happening again in the same place, and we think it's fishy. And Saad Zarlul took the safe side, saying that every kind of protest should stop in Egypt, or else the cause is going to be lost. I don't have more time to say what I have prepared, so yeah. It's just the second kept coming on, the murder of Ali Fahmy. I don't know if you remember this incident by his French wife in 1923, escalated another stereotyping episode with accusing foreign women of being indecent, coming to Egypt to marry the rich Egyptian men and then kill them. And this is another market is getting ready to kill her husband. And it kept going. In my paper, I try also to engage with other points, like the invitation of foreign professors to Cairo University, but that's a bit of a latest point. And there was a big battle from Al-Manar Rashid Rida with Taha Hussein, and they were each were defending their side of the story. We have to bring foreign professors to university. Rashid Rida was replying that we're bringing occupation back again, imperialism back again in another form. And it just goes on and on. And
I'm so sorry. You have so much more to say. And we were enjoying what you told us so much. If I could ask our three speakers to come and take the seats at the front, we'll now move from our presentations to our discussion. To get us started, I would like to begin by saying how wonderfully I thought these three papers cohered around a set of themes that discuss the contradictions in colonialism provoked by the Great War in three very different settings. In Harrison's paper, we see where Transjordan, if one were to look for a creation of the Great War, you didn't have to look any further. With the Hashemite prince as its head, and with its boundaries drawn out of imperial necessity from a process that starts in Sykes-Picot and ends in San Remo, we have this wonderful contradiction of the British trying to impose institutions to achieve buy-in to legitimate their presence, but in which they do not allow to the indigenous people a voice that would effectively give buy-in for this. And then in the contradictions that emerged here, we saw a problem that gave rise to a strong opposition in what in many ways was Britain's easiest of mandates, a process not totally different from the experience of trying to create a constituent assembly to approve a similar agreement in Iraq. So they should have known better. But the fact that the British were slow to learn from experience perhaps comes as a surprise. Not that the French experience of colonialism, from what we have heard about the experience of Algerian veterans of the war, suggests that they were any better at learning from experience. Here, the French knew full well, even before the Great War broke out, that were they to introduce conscription to what had until then been an entirely volunteer army in North Africa, the contradictions of making the ultimate demand of your subjects without giving them the full rights as citizens would raise their ugly head. And indeed, the colonial lobby worked very hard in the pre-war months, 1913, 1914, to block an initiative which allowed for actually quite a minor conscription, but nonetheless set the principle in motion. Perhaps the most surprising thing to emerge from Dónal's paper is how long the veterans, the indigenous veterans of the Great War, waited before they took political action to begin to demand their right, to begin to demand their legitimate rights. They had, after all, not only served and suffered in the Great War, but they'd watched many of their comrades and friends cut down around them, wounded and killed in the industrial warfare of the Western Front. And so it's, if anything, quite surprising that it's not until 1930 that we really begin this discussion. Perhaps you could explain what took so long for them to get organized. But the thing that I really took away from your paper that was news to me, Dónal, was I had always taken the Bloomvillette Accords to be something that recognized the rights of essentially those who would be entitled to service. The fact that it was a minority of veterans who would have benefited from this, and that actually divided the ranks of the Veterans Association, tells you so much about why a measure only got half support from the Algerians, and great opposition from the French, was less likely to pass than perhaps many of those who have criticized this very moderate measure of assimilation for not going through. And Amany, you could have gone on for hours. The material you were giving to us was so rich and so fascinating. I have to admit, my heart sunk when I heard you begin with 1882. I thought we were getting very far from the Great War indeed. But in explaining the waves of foreigners and the cosmopolitan society of Egypt that resulted, you were the first person to systematically destroy the romance of cosmopolitanism. And done Zagel by Zagel. We have, perhaps in the Zagels of people like Hussein Darwish, the best antidote to the poetry of Kafafi, if we're looking at recovering for Alexandria its Egyptian heritage, and with such rights. Not that one would ever want to encourage xenophobia or hostility towards foreigners, but that this relationship that emerged from the British presence and British occupation was one which complicated the lives of the average Egyptian is undeniable. And that people should have expressed resentments in moments of political tensions, particularly those that emerged in the First World War, seems only natural. But I can only take my hat off to you for having brought it to light in a way which truly I have not seen done before. So I promised you three papers at the cutting edge of new research on the Great War and its impact on the colonial situation. First off, join me in applauding our three speakers and then hit them with a question. Floor is open. Mohammed Mladeni.
Thank you, Mohammed Mladeni. I agree with you. How the Muslim Brotherhood reaction was to all this at that period? That's for them.
There wasn't a Brotherhood.
Donald, in the 30s, the French army produced magazines in Arabic. For especially for the Algerian soldiers, big series of those magazines. And they tried to convince him that they are fighting a jihad against these infidels. So did you manage to examine this magazine? So
well, I don't work on the actual period of the war itself, but this ties in with some other something that I work on quite extensively, which is an organization called the Amitiés Africaines, which was set up by the unofficially by the French government. So it's a charity set up by military leaders to look after veterans of the First World War and to prevent them from being involved in nationalist activity, and it provides. Special places for Muslim veterans to go during Ramadan. It provides feasts and Muslim holidays. It provides literature saying that fighting in the French army is fighting for the jihad. Mm-hmm. It provides all this kind of attempt to say that France, unlike Britain, for example, or unlike fascist Italy, is a Muslim power and recognizes the glory of Islam. And then this is tied into, they pay for veterans to go to Mecca. They give privilege to veterans and all kind of religious activities. They set up, they build a mosque in Paris, which is a commemoration for the people who died in the First World War. So it's an attempt to try and say that you fought for Islam and you fought for France, which the nationalists and the Salih Hajj are very strongly opposed to and speak really eloquently against.
Please.
Amany Soliman, as you mentioned, the sort of perceived influence of foreign women, was there actually some kind of influence coming from women to Egypt?
Yes, there was. And Judith Itaker did a lot of work on that. And she said that it was the engagement between the Egyptian women and the foreign women, especially those who entered Egyptian harem as teachers, they could really open the door slowly for Egyptian women, showing them what they cannot see from their mashrabiya, or the small window. And Judith Tucker says that it happened like slowly, but this because the Egyptian aristocracy wanted to teach their girls French, piano playing, and all these things, and they couldn't bring a man to teach these women. So they brought French women, Greek women, Armenian women, and their influence was there, of course.
Amany, the Mamlekat al-Jins al-Latif, was that a weekly column, or was that a sort of headline?
Just a headline in Abu.
Okay, so that wasn't a weekly column on feminist issues. Okay, I was thinking, Jason.
Jason Black of Cambridge University. I wanted to say that the paper was fascinating, Harrison, and it reminded me of the debates over the Portsmouth Treaty in the 1940s, which caused the Wathba reaction. You said at one point, and I'd like you to expand on this, because I don't know as much about this Jordan episode, that the emir was surprised at the counter-reaction of opposition. And that's kind of what that Wathba connection, that they had no idea that there would be these protests in Baghdad while these things were going on. Could you explain to me what he thought was happening? What did he think signing this treaty would accomplish for him or the Hashemite dynasty, why it was necessary if the British already had the mandate? I know you mentioned at the beginning, but I wasn't completely clear at all.
No, it's a good point to bring up. So Abdullah, the way the agreement is originally couched, is the mandate terms have been set, but the 1928 agreement would legalize and formalize the form of the government itself, in that there would be certain types of elections, that the emir had this set of types of powers, legislative council had this type of powers, the judiciary was set up with this type of powers. And the agreement also came with what's called the organic law, which is essentially the first constitution of Transjordan. They were viewed as a package. So I didn't talk about the organic law explicitly because no one really questions the terms of the organic law. They accept lots of more law that was already in place. They just kind of cobbled and pushed it together and said, here are the things you should accept. When you were saying, though, why Abdullah is surprised, he takes it as a personal attack against his legitimacy. So he views it as, I am a Sharif. I am the son of Hussein. That no one should be questioning me. So all of these different letters, he takes them as personal attacks. And he gets very angry about it. They're in his minute, his communicates back and forth with the British, he lambasts the boycotts. Why would they boycott the right to have an election? Why would they question this clear agreement which will better them and help them along? So he's continually perplexed by any opposition to him as the emir. And oddly enough, people's opposition, as I said, there's always this divorce between the opposition to the government and opposition against the monarchy. So the idea of the Hashemites themselves are very, very rarely attacked. It is always some action of the government that is attacked, or some minister or the British side of the government is attacked, even though Abdullah is frequently signing off on everything the British want him to do. He pushes back sometimes, but a lot of it he acknowledges that there's a phrase by Toby Dodge when he refers to Iraq, saying that it was a sovereign without any sovereignty. And it very much applies to Abdullah as well. The Hashemites were sovereigns without sovereignty before the agreements. So this was their way of seeing themselves being vindicated and put in a permanent stance in the mandate. Because there was nothing before this point that made it that Abdullah was going to be the permanent leader. It wasn't until the agreement that a Hashemite dynasty, or the idea of one, was even a formalized idea. Because when he's originally approved as an outgrowth of the Cairo conference, he only has a 6-month, essentially, probationary appointment. And it just kind of keeps getting extended. So this is the first time it's actually formalized in the agreement.
And could you explain why the British wanted to have that legislative council? Couldn't they have just established a monarchy to rule?
They could have, but the way they set up both the agreements in Iraq and then later in Transjordan is they wanted some form of representational government to approve the agreement.
Well, and they needed that by the League of Nations.
And that's the other side. The League of Nations stipulates some, remember, these are supposed to help and bring these countries along, and the way you're doing so is by developing a semblance of a democratic system. So even though both the councils in Iraq and Transjordan are very limited, that's the idea of why they exist.
Yeah.
So they both eventually become part of the parliament when both countries become independent. It's that direct continuity.
Are there any other questions? Two more. We'll take both of those questions, and I think we will need to make our move back to the main theater. So please.
Thank you all for most fascinating. This is Mona Namori from Santo University, Egypt. Thank you for a most fascinating presentation. My comment is to Amany. It's not a question, Amany, but your presentation was quite insightful to me because I remembered what my grandmother used to tell me about the Greeks. In my hometown is called Kafrizayel. It's a small town halfway between Alexandria and Cairo, which used to be full of Greeks, and they used to be the best tailors and the best groceries of the country. And my grandmother, who looked like them because she was fair and she was blonde, was always called Al-Khawagaya by others, she and her daughters, my mother included. And obviously that was a source of pride to her. So this now makes sense to me that obviously the Greeks somehow looked down a little bit on the inhabitants of the town, distinguishing themselves by being the best grocers and the cleanest and everything, and of course distinguishing themselves by being fair and looking European. And because my grandmother looked somehow like them, that was a source of pride to her. So your presentation gave me insight about the complexity of relationships between the Greeks or any other Europeans residing in Egypt at that time and the Egyptians at that time. Thank you so much. Thank you.
But I have a reservation on that because I don't think that the Greeks had anything to do with them being blonde. It wasn't. But the fact is, many of them were just living, mingling with Egyptians because my dad, he was born in the early 1950s, but my elder uncles told me that in Attarin in Alexandria, you cannot find one building that it doesn't have at least one or two apartments inhabited by the Greeks. So they were everywhere, in the poor neighborhoods, in the rich neighborhoods. Some of them were, as I said, kontarbi or shoemaker, and some even were beggars in the streets of Alexandria.
Yeah.
So you cannot say that they were always privileged. I don't think so.
No.
And with the Masr, they were Egyptianized.
Yes, of course.
And their language was Arabic.
Obviously, my grandmother used to mingle with them.
Yeah.
You see.
Please.
Yes, Karim Hauser from Casa Arabe, a public diplomacy institution in Spain. It's for Amany the question, and the subject of your presentation was the rise of Egyptian nationalism and the perception of foreigners. You gave us lots of examples, and I was just wondering if who was consuming this? I mean, who was reading El Masamir? Was it mostly an elite, or I mean, are we talking about the perception of the foreigner in media? I mean, in the burgeoning press, who was watching Kishkish? Do we have different types of perception from the elites who are consuming this and from the people who are experiencing the revolts of Abdin or the ones in Alexandria? I don't know if you could elaborate on how is that perceived by
the population. First of all, the percentage of the literacy in Egypt was between 3% and 5%, so reading in Masamir was not something that everyone could do. But the jump happened when Said Darwish started to take the stage. People like Naguib al-Rahani, who was Syrian, by the way, not Egyptian, Syrian, and Christian. And they started to take it to another level of street songs. And people, like, they say that the song of Said Darwish was starting by dawn in Alexandria, and by the end of the day, it's in Aswan. Mm-hmm. So So it was easy, it was light, and new music, and it was just, he puts whatever he wants to say in 7 or 8 lines with Yunus al-Adi, per se, or Muhammad Abdul Rasul, or Bayram al-Tunsi, and then it spans all over Egypt very fast. Kish Kish Bey.
Word by mouth? Or word
yes,
of
word
mouth?
By mouth. Yeah. Yes, word by mouth. And sometimes, in certain times, especially people like Bayram al-Tunsi, he was making like small leaflets with his zagel, and it was sold for like malim or something. So it was very cheap, and even if you are not capable of reading, you would give it to someone who can, and then they keep narrating it until memorizing it. And especially in the time of the revolt, everyone felt involved, and they just wanted to look organized. So in many of the protesters, they were singing the song of Said Darwish and some of the excerpts from Kish Kish Bey.
I mean, that's the power of zagel.
Yes.
It rhymes.
Yes.
Yes.
And so it sticks to your brain like tape.
Yeah.
And for a non-literate culture, the way you broadcast a message is by poetry. So zagel is very, very powerful, that way, popular language with a rhyme. I think we're going to have to bring this session to a close, regretfully, because it has been just a very quick 2 hours. But we should make our way back to the Brunei Gallery for this evening's closing session with Ala Al-Aswadi. And I would just like you all to thank our speakers once again.